Indeed, what I sort of described before, in a maybe not in sort of vague, okay, in some terms, general terms. Now I will be very concrete. So I'm now just indeed begin to asymptotically analyze this Riemann-Hilbert problem. So in any case, I have advantage. My N is just involved here and there. So it is not just some size of Riemann-Hilbert problem becomes infinite, it is just fixed. But I am going, so what is the strategy? The strategy is to perform a sequence of, explicit transformation from one to T to S. Usually this is the lattice we use. So that to get in the end, Riemann-Hilbert problem, whose jump matrix is close to identity. And then this is the only way where we are going to use mathematics of 20th century, because all this is the 19th century. When we kind of can transform this by analyzing singular integral operators corresponding to Riemann-Hilbert problem, we can transform this small norm, the closest to identity of the jump matrix, to the closest to identity of this last matrix. And then we can kind of accumulate all previous calculi and get asymptotics for Y. So now let us just do it in our example. First step, from Y to T, what is the meaning of this step? So you see, again, it is, again, I have to scroll up. This is what it makes, not very, I'm sorry. I'm still not. So again, look at this problem. So this is the bad part on this problem. If n is zero, I can solve immediately. So it is triangular Riemann-Hilbert problem. I take logarithm, or I just by just one contour integral, it is a solution. So this formula for the solution would give. So I want to get rid of z to the n. If I can replace it by the identity, then it, well, it preserve, then it would be great. Well, partially I can do it by this first transformation. It is very natural to do, in fact. And this is a, Volodya, what is the difference with the Hankel determinant? I cannot do, so this is a very trivial thing. Why behaves as z to the n sigma 3 at infinity? Let us just kill it. So let us introduce new function t such that it is my y outside of the unit circle times this z to the minus n sigma 3, and inside it is the previous y. Then yes, I would get just identity at infinity, but the price is that I corrupted my original triangular matrix. So Volodya, this is what I cannot do in for orthogonal polynomials on the line. If I do this thing, I would get just huge singularity at zero.
I see.
But here it does not matter. It is on the unit circles. Everything is, it is just oscillatory. Of course, the problem is oscillatory. So this is why I cannot make immediately. And now it is not commutative problem anymore. So this matrices for different Z do not commute. So I cannot take logarithm. So I cannot solve it explicitly. But I can get rid of this oscillation. So I can replace, just like when I do contour integral estimation. I try to transform oscillatory terms, oscillatory kernels, to exponentially decay, correct? This is it. And this is how basically we do it here too. But of course, the techniques are different. The basic thing is this, it is sort of LDU factorization of my matrix. You just can check it directly that this equals that. So this is oscillation. I am on the unit circle and I kind of replace it by this. And now look, now I have to make an important technical assumption. Now I'm going to assume that phi is analytic in the annulus around unit circle. So this is where Riemann-Hilbert approach. But again, in the examples, it is always the case, sort of. Because always phi is given explicitly. But generically, for the generic, to prove for most generic conditions, it is of course a problem. I have to then approximate. So if I want to proceed for the general phi, I have to approximate in the binary. But now let us assume that phi is analytic in the annulus. Then look, this guy would behave very well outside of unit circle. Oscillation would become exponential decay. This thing would behave very well inside, a little bit inside of unit circle, then it would be exponentially small. Well, this would live. So it means my second step from T to S. So this is C, my original unit circle. This is, I introduce four domains, omega naught. It is, I'm just consider gamma naught, which is a little bit inside of the unit circle, gamma one, which is a little bit outside. And I have 1, 2, 3, 4 domains. And I introduce S. S is T in every way in omega infinity. And in omega naught, it is my previous T. No changes. But in omega two, it is T times this matrix. It is, you see, T times this matrix. It is, I incorporate this matrix into T. In omega one, it is T times this matrix. So I incorporate, so this inverse matrix to T plus. So I incorporate this matrix to T minus, this matrix to T plus. Well, as I said, this is a key assumption. So of course I can do it only assuming that. And so what about S? S now would be, of course, analytic. S would be, of course, jump. It would have jumps on three. So now the contour for S, I would get new Riemann-Hilbert problem. Contour for S, it is three circles, gamma one, C, gamma naught. And this is what it has. So in the unit circle, it has this of diagonal phi minus one. And on those two circles, it has this matrix and that matrix. And look, those two matrices are exponentially close to identity. That's the whole trick. They're exponentially close. I forgot to indicate it for this matrix too, but it is exactly the same. So some it is some row, it depends on the radius, of course, of these circles. So heuristically, I can forget about these jumps. They're exponentially close to identity. So heuristically, I would expect that my S is represented just by this jump matrix. So it is represented by what we call global parametrics, P infinity, which solves the following Riemann-Hilbert problem. It is analytic outside of unit circle. It has this jump on the circle. It is identity at infinity. Look, there is no N. So in a sense, heuristically, I constructed asymptotics. So this is my S is going to be, this is my P is going to represent S for large N. And then I can go back, of course, to Y. Well, there is, of course, rigorous statement. So this is a heuristic and rigorous statement. This is where we should use indeed elements of the functional analysis. That in fact, what I really can claim that this S would be represented by the P with this error term, uniformly on S, on all whole complex plane. So it is, you know, it is identity plus exponentially small, and it behaves very nice with respect to Z. Well, again, I have to skip it because I want to explain you some tricks, but a little bit more detail how it goes. So this is the last transformation R from S to R. I just divide my S by this, what I assume, what I expect to be its asymptotic representation. And for R, of course, this division eliminates for S original S has three jump contours, but this division eliminates unit circle. And I only have on gamma one and gamma naught, I have my previous matrix, which were exponentially close to identity just by this similar, just by conjugated by this P infinity. P infinity doesn't depend on N. It is going to be bound. Okay, we have to discuss how we can, but if you believe me that I can construct P infinity explicitly and it is absolutely decent function, then this jump matrix for R is going to be like that. And then indeed, this reference to the general theorem from singular integral operators, that if I have this JR kernel close to identity, then the solution is also, it is based, by the way, it is based on the only fact which we really use is that the Cauchy operator is L2 bounded for other complicated contours. Well, in my case, contours are not complicated, so this can be even kind of I can manage even without this big theorem. But in other application, I need it. I have some contours with an intersection. I need Cauchy operator to be L2 bounded. Then I can translate closeness to identity of the kernel to the closeness to identity of the solution. Now, if I have time, I may say more about it. But now we see that we reduce our problem to the solution of this Riemann-Hilbert problem. And look, it can be solved explicitly. I just can, if I factorize phi, and this is where, and this is a classical Wiener-Hopf. So this is where I match classical approaches. So this is a Segeur function. If I factorize phi, and this is given like that, I can factorize phi. Then I can factorize this matrix. It is just given like that. And so my P infinity is given by this explicit formula. And this is again a good place for me to mention about block Toeplitz determinants. It is going to be in this place, I would have interesting challenge. Because it is for scalar, of course, I can write it immediately the answer. But for if phi is matrix, then I have either just pronounce this factorization without any explicit formulas, or try to solve it. And as I said, in the situation of the Toeplitz determinants that appears in entanglement of xy 1/2 chain, we exactly have, we managed to factorize it. It's 2x2 algebraic, 2x2 algebraic matrix. We factorize it in terms of Riemann theta functions. And by the way, it was one of the first time as I did not know that. Okay, but this is a different story. So that is where there is a relation to the, and well, that's it. So this is we construct asymptotics of Y. So this P infinity gives asymptotic for S. And if I go back to my Y, I would get Y. So asymptotic for Y is fine. Now the second step, it is to get asymptotic of the determinant. To get asymptotics of the determinant. Well, this is, here we are going to use this formula. You remember there was this identity for the determinant, where Y must be, of course, be given by the family of the weights. Again, I assume that for any gamma, I can, it is, of course, here I assume that it is not only analytic on the annulus, but it is usual Segeur conditions. So most of all, phi is not zero on the circle, and it is, of course, has zero index. I forgot to say, this is, of course, necessary too. This is where I need the classical Segeur condition. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I assume that again, for all gamma, I have this classical Segeur condition. Now, from the previous analysis, so which y I have to take. It does not matter. This is the first column of my y, it is the polynomials. So it is a, there is no difference between plus and minus. So for instance, if I take y plus, it is from my previous analysis, it is t plus inside of unit circle, and it is s plus times this matrix, and s plus it is up to this small exponential term p infinity times that. So it is just this. And so this is the formulas which I have for my first column. Y11 is this explicit first term up to the exponentially small, and Y21, it is this very simple. There is no n at all. I also have to have derivatives. Well, differentiate this, it is a derivative of the it is the first derivative of the y, then I differentiate z, it is this term, and then I differentiate gamma. So this sign means derivative with respect to z. And y21, it is very simple, it is just this. Therefore, this my integrand is given, it has three terms. It comes from the derivative of alpha, this comes from the derivative of z, this comes from the derivative of phi. And hence, the logarithm of dn up to the exponentially small term is the sum of those three integrals. So now it is just a very nice exercise from four, I don't know. in my years, it was a third grade, yes, third the course of complex analysis, yes, so the third year. So to calculate those integrals, let's do it. The first integral, you remember phi was this thing. So if I differentiate with respect to gamma, I just phi minus one. So this is easy. So phi minus one, it is just derivative with respect to gamma. So my first integral, it is just this combination. It is just, I have to integrate the integral with respect to gamma. I just get it explicitly. It is logarithm of phi at z. And so what is this? It is just n times average of logarithm phi. This is the first term in the Segier-Strong theorem. This is the first term in Segier-Strong theorem. Now E2, it is this, it is when I have to integrate this thing. But this time I noticed that the same difference, phi minus one, it is not only the derivative of phi gamma with respect to gamma, but also just phi gamma minus one divided by gamma. So it can be rewritten as the sum of those two derivatives. And the integral again with respect to gamma can be taken explicitly. It is a full differentials. It is those two terms, but it is a just substitution along all the c is zero because we assume that there is no index. And this is also because it is a just the function on the c. So substitution also zero. So it is zero. So the second term is zero. So the only terms that we have to work with it is I3. So I3, it is, let me remind, I3, it is, we have to integrate this thing. So first of all, we have to see, and this is more complicated because now this is also integral. Yes, so alpha is also integrals. So I have actually triple integral here. So let me first play with alpha plus. Well, this is a formula for logarithm alpha plus. Well, I have to take z taking from inside, but my phi is allows me to go a little bit up to replace c by c plus, and then I can, and then z just z. So this is a formula for alpha plus. It is the integral on c plus, which is a little bit out of unit circle. Now it is a great integral, I can differentiate. So alpha plus alpha minus one, it is just, so the logarithmic derivative, it is just this integral. Okay, So it means in I3 we have triple integral. We have triple integral. So integral with respect to gamma from 0 to 1, C, this is where S lives. And C, it is where Z lives. And S, it is where C plus, it is where S lives. It was from here. Now, a little bit of cheating. This function is sort of, let me replace S by Z, Z by S. This is symmetric. So I can replace this two by just full derivative of this product. So this is a mini course. This is a homework to prove. So where is the cheating? Because I have to switch C's also. So there is a, so when I just replace, I would have S and Z on the wrong places. So I have to actually move from S to C. I would get residue, of course. So I would get some extra term, but it is zero. Its contribution is zero. But anyway, so this is just kind of the saying that is symmetric. I would just arrive to this. I integrated with respect to gamma. I get these formulas. Now it is already, we are very close to this Ziegler E, capital E. So of course I can rewrite this integral as a first integral with respect to Z, and this the square S minus Z squared, it is just the derivative with respect to Z of this integral. Now again, the favorite trick with geometric progression. And I have geometric series. I replace this integral by this sum. Well, this is nothing else but K Fourier coefficients, ZK, differentiation with respect to K, and changing summation of integration. Well, bring me to the answer. That's it. Assembly calls three integrals, we get strong Ziegler theorem. So this is a derivation of strong Ziegler theorem using Riemann-Hilbert approach. So I just took it from the Davids review on integrable operators, on his review on the Biermann's, one of the Biermann's volumes. Of course, it is. I have not produced it for the all. And in that problem with the entanglement, we get the similar things for the block Toeplitz case. Of course, by the way, there is a rhythm obtained. Yeah. This is the main names of the strong Ziegler theorems. Of course, Ziegler himself. But in fact, the first should be mentioned. On Zeiger and Kaufmann, so they worked on the Ising model, and they reduce evaluation of the important object of the so-called two-point correlation functions which leads to magnetization, whose limit leads to magnetization of the model. To evaluation of the asymptotics of the certain Toeplitz determinant. And at that time, they also had available the so-called weak Ziegler theorem, only this with this term. And it would not enough. In fact, this it was kind of zero. And so the magnetization you should need the constant. And they wanted to calculate constant. And they actually calculated it, but it was an exchange already, and Ziegler arrived to some formula which then he knew about this problem and also did this. Okay, that is a story. Well, then of course Widom, by the way, obtained the analog for block Toeplitz, but the point is that Widom's answer does not so efficient like that. Again, for the arbitrary block matrix phi, it is not it is not it is not possible to write something like this. You just write certain, the determinant of certain, again, Toeplitz matrix. But for algebraic symbols, we managed to get it easier. And also, by the way, there are more or less simultaneous, there are these examples in Dimer's model when also block Toeplitz determinant appeared. And Estelle Bazor and Thorsten Erhard, they also managed to get efficient answer for. So this is a very few known answers for when for block. For block phi, you can get explicit constant. Well, now it is okay. So I believe I still have some time, 20 minutes.
Yes.
So, and you are okay, or you're already tired. So now it is
20 to 30 minutes actually.
Huh?
Because as you like, you can use even more than 20 minutes.
But it is look at this in this screen. I think for you guys it is difficult. So, but okay. Again, I apologize. I bought finally iPad, but I still don't know how to. I tried even to try, but I because I teach, because I've been taught in person. Uh-huh. So I didn't have a stimulus to. Okay, now what I want to do next. So I want to end up with the appearance in the scheme of the Painlevé equations. But the intermediate step, it is to appearance of the classical special functions. So it is Fischer-Hartwig asymptotics. So now this is a formula for the smooth weight. Mm-hmm. Now let's consider the singular situation. So this is the first, again, it appeared in Ising model. So this is a kind of simplest case with only one Fischer-Hartwig singularity. Let me describe it. So weight is this. I have what we call Sigyo part. So this is a good. So V is a just Lorentz series. So it is an analytical function in the annulus. And since I wrote it in this way, it means that index is zero. So to write phi in this way, it is a manifestation that this Sigyo part is not zero and index is zero. So it can be written as this exponential term. And phi is, and this is phi k, it is just the Fourier coefficients of logarithm this function. And then there is this singularity. So this is called Fischer-Hartwig singularity. It is a root singularity plus jump singularity. So I just have one singularity at point one. Root singularity, of course, I have to assume this condition so that I could integrate phi. Now, z beta, it is argument, so this is a, this functions well is from zero to two pi arguments, argument. So this is how I define this weight. And this is a tradition. So this term is just manifestate that when you go with this function over the unit circle from the above to one, you get e to the minus IP beta. When you go from the below, you get e to the plus IP beta. So the difference, the jump is e to the two IP beta. And beta is any. Of course, the more interesting thing it is when you have several Fischer-Hartwig singularities. And this is a principal names. So first of all, there is the answer which was conjectured by Fischer and Hartwig. This is why it calls Fischer-Hartwig conjecture and Fischer-Hartwig. Then different cases were proven over the span of the years by Widom, Bazor, Bocher, and Silverman, and eventually in most complete way it was proven by Erhard. What is the answer? Let me now present the answer. But again, it is more complicated part, it is to consider several several jumps, but then we have just one. So this is the answer. The answer is, look, these two terms, it is what we had before, exactly. This is just the asymptotics of the Segeau part. This is what we have because we have jump and singularity. So it means that now determinant behaves not only like exponent, linear exponent, but also it has power behavior. So n to this power. And then constant terms. So again, the part of the constant term, it is what we had before. And then this constant term is the sort of interaction between the Segeau constant and Fischer-Hartwig constant. And this term, it is a sort of interaction between roots and jump singularities. So what is this guy? This is a Barnes G function. It is a kind of also very interesting, well, non-trivial function, but it is a sort of a discrete antiderivative of gamma function. And it also has a representation as an infinite product. And also it has contour integral representation. So it is function which appears as Barnes function is appears in, again, in integrable quantum and classical system. It appears. So you write asymptotics, it is for Volodya. So when you write asymptotics for the solution of Schrödinger equation and for KdV, you get gamma functions. So your face is gamma. But if you want to write asymptotics for the Marchenko determinant itself, then you would get G functions. You have to integrate sort of.
I see.
Gamma function. And so appearance of G functions, again, in asymptotics of the classical integrable system, very much kind of motivated. And also in quantum integrals, it is they describe the scattering matrices on integrable systems. So this is one of the gamma function, G functions. Now Riemann-Hilbert analysis. Well, here it is important. So the first things I have to explain to you what is going on at point when I have singularity. So now this jump condition is taking only, of course, on C outside of singularity, outside of point one. Because otherwise it is kind of not defined. So I have to prescribe separately, specifically, what is going on when Z equals one. Around Z equals one. And it is enough only to say that it is okay, it is bounded the first column and the second column might have, you know, this sort of thing. So if alpha is positive, then there is no singularity at all. If alpha is negative, it might be. So where I took this? Well, this is again, I have just for the few minutes, remember orthogonal polynomial origin. I have again look at my integrals in my representation function y in terms of orthogonal polynomials, and this would be the behavior of that Cauchy integral of the which appears in the second columns. Now it is again sort of homework. You can check that again with these conditions, solution is unique if exists. So solution is unique. You can only now to be a little bit more careful when you consider differences that you would have some removable singularity at one for all your ratios. Okay, so this is an important remark about the setting of the problem. Now we start doing as before. So the first move is just to get rid of z to the n at infinity. Then we have for t exactly the same problem. Again, I can write this factorization, but now it is phi is not analytic in the annulus. Let us look at phi more attentively. This absolute value to alpha can be actually written like this. I can just rewrite this absolute value as the product of those two, of these two branching functions, those two multivalued functions. Z minus one to alpha is defined along this cut with this, and Z to the alpha is defined along this cut. So you might surprise why I get this Z. This is explanation. So Z minus one to alpha, it is Z minus one times its complex conjugated. Then complex conjugated on the unit circle can be rewritten like this. This is how you get to this formula. So now it means our phi is analytic in, it can be, yes, this is a unit circle. And now what I can do, I can just write those two curves and I can go, my phi can be analytically continued everywhere here, but not around this point. Here I have a nail. So now if before I have just two annulus, I have just two circles, here I have a nail. I have to keep it. So now this is a complication. And now this is why we usually call the second step when I introduce function S lenses opening. So this is now called lenses. Now look, what we do. So far it is the same. So everywhere outside one and four domains, it is just T. In domains two, it is again T times this matrix. In domains three, it is T times that matrix. This is the same, but only now it is not on the annulus domains, but it is on this sort of domains. And so S problem is a problem again on the union of those three contours. I have these jumps as before. And Z equals one, I also have to, it is just what it is inherited behavior at Z point, at Z equals one from what I had in Y. You might trust me that this is okay. So so in one and four, it is exactly what it was for Y, but in two and three, I have to take into account these factors. Now, again, I have that this jump matrices of S on gamma naught and gamma one, again, close to identity, but outside some small neighborhood. So now that's the point. So now it is, I can expect heuristically that I can indeed represent solution S by global parametrics, but only outside of this U. Outside of this U, it is natural to expect that S is represented by this global parametrics. Well, inside of this U, it should be represented by something, but so it should be some local, which we call local parametrics. And I expect that I can somehow simplify the problem. Just like, so ideology is the same as with the asymptotic estimation of integrals. You kind of forget about, you kind of go to the localize your integral. Outside of your neighborhoods, it is kind of exponentially small. Inside, you replace your integrants by Taylor series, and you get model integrals, and you get answer. The same ideology, but of course, the technical part is different. So global parametrics, but let us just again say, look, in global parametrics, I'm not, this is what I want from my function P. I want to factorize this. I want to factorize this jump on C outside of one. And I don't care what is going on with P at one, because I'm going to, anyway, I need only some P that satisfies this condition, because I'm going to use it outside of one, outside of U. and we can kind of just find it. So this is, again, we can use the Segeau function. It is also appears in these problems. So I want to, first of all, I want indeed to factorize, at least outside of one, this phi. Well, now before it was in my Segeau part, it was alpha of z, but now I have alpha z. So I switch to another letter. So now it is a Segeau function. I call this curl d. So I want to factorize. It can be, of course, done kind of by hand. Just I can write, of course, logarithm of integrate Cauchy integral, Cauchy transform of logarithm, but it is easier to do it just by hand. So this is my phi. Yes, this is my phi. Now v, it is the sum of v plus v minus. So v plus v minus. Yes, so it is part analytical inside, part analytical outside. Good, it is clear with this. Now with this, what I can rewrite this thing as z minus one alpha plus beta, z minus one over z alpha minus beta. And now look, these things, of course, is analytic inside. I can define it as analytical function inside unit circle. And this is, of course, analytical function outside. For this function, I can define the cut from one to infinity, and it becomes analytic inside. From this function, I define cut from zero to infinity, and becomes analytic outside. And so this is answer. So d of z I can now just kind of the split it. So this function becomes d plus, and this function becomes d minus. Well, inverse of this function. So this is the answer for Segeau function, and this is the answer for P infinity. So this is the easy part. Now, local parametrics. Well, for local parametrics, I would probably do the tomorrow, because it's really kind of a long story, but let me just start. Let me just outline. You see, this is what I take my microscope and I see what is going on in near this one. If this is a part, this is an arc. This is a contour. It is an arc of unit circle. These are parts of gamma naught. This is a parts of gamma one. So we have this sort. On those curves, we have this jump. On those curves, we have this jump. And on the unit circle, we still have this one. Now I am going to do a sequence of additional transformation, local transformation. I am going to locally transform my S. Well, look, since I am local, this is why I'm local, I can clean a lot of my data. First of all, my function phi is analytic here. So if I just make this cut, I would be able to my phi is analytic. So my phi is analytic. So it means I can make, for instance, the first transformation from S to S tilde, I just multiply S by this diagonal matrix with phi one half, phi one half. And this would, so I undress. So in our terminology, dressing. I undress my this local problem by getting rid of those phis. It is just by this transformation, I get only this now in jump matrices. Only this is one minus one even. Well, the price is some extra cut here. So I have now this extra contour. So this is now how the local problem looks like. Now it is the time to change locally, the variable z. So go from variable z to variable zeta. So locally around one, this is a holomorphic change. This is a holomorphic change. And I map my u to this picture. So you see, there is this n. So in fact, this picture goes kind of to infinity. But I treat all these arcs as pre-images of the straight line of the rays. So this is what I arrived at. I arrive at the moment I'm not talking about, I arrived at, I call it phi naught of z. So now I introduce, so this is a kind of the solution of the this problem. I haven't described it in all details, but this is what I want. I want to have function which on plane zeta has these jumps. Well, then I have to torture you with more. So now I want to make the number of jumps, reduce the number of jumps. There are a lot of constant jumps. So I just, you see, I can get rid of vertical jump. I just can incorporate this jump into the right part of function phi naught. This is what I'm doing. It is phi one, phi naught times this on the right. It means I eliminated jump around straight line. So I have this. Now the going to phi two. I want to get rid of this jump because again, this is a constant. Again, I don't know yet what is going on at infinity because it is a different issue. So I just multiply this part of the function by this exponent and this part of the function by that exponent. And so I get this jump. So this is my phi two. It now has jumps. And look, all the exponents are okay. So this is exponent is, you know, when zeta goes to infinity, it goes to zero. So this is a correct sign. So all those exponents are correct signs. I have a last transformation. I can just move these two jumps, combine them into the jumps around positive axis. And these two jumps combine into the jump around negative axis. It is done by the following transformation. I take F2, and in this part, I multiply it just by this matrix. And on this part, I multiply it just by this matrix. And the same I do with this part and with this part. I multiply by the proper matrices. And now it is my finite. So this is probably would be the good place to stop. So this is my finite local problem. Well, local already mapped to the zeta plane. So the function has jumps on this contour. It is a real line and negative part of imaginary line. So it has this triangular matrix with this exponent jump on the right, this triangular matrix exponent jump to the left. This is S1, S2. This is what I got after I combine those two matrices. So this is the exponent becomes just sine functions. So this is S1, this is S2. Explicit formulas in terms of alpha beta. Now, and this is some sort of, I have not explained to you yet. I claim that to complete the problem, I of course have now to say what is going on at infinity of zeta. And I am saying that at infinity, I want this behavior, which is by the way, consistent with this jump. At infinity, I want this behavior. What is going on at zero now, it is a zero. Well, what it was one in z plane, it is zero in zeta. I say that up to the, this is a galomorphic function at zero. It is this branch with some constant matrices, which I can choose. Well, again, this needs to be explained, but this is needs to be explained less than this one, because this is can be traced. I can just trace it from what it was on z. So now what is the idea now? Now I hope to solve this problem explicitly. If I solve it explicitly, I then can construct local parametrics, P, which is what P1. And then I can, and we will see that to solve this problem, I actually will use some ideas from integrable systems. I will show that this problem, it satisfies, so this problem can be, so the function F3, which satisfies this problem, it satisfies some linear differential equation on Z. And this linear differential equation, in fact, can be solved in confluent hypergeometric functions. And those S's, it is just the Stokes parameters of these hypergeometric functions. So there is a very, very important conceptual moment in this. So it is not just technicalities. It is a very, very important conceptual point. And I am going to start with this in more details tomorrow. So I think that it is a good point to stop. Okay.
Okay.
Have I lost you guys?
Thank you. No, it's okay.
Mm-hmm. All besides the last part was very understandable, but about local parametrics.
Okay. I will kind of, I will make overlap. So I will sort of. That's sure. Yes. So that was, again, as I said, it is basically okay. So if there are questions, if I can clarify anything, please ask. But yes, first of all, I got this order, so to say, Valodi, that I will try to say again a little bit more, maybe start with local parametrics, of course, it is the most important. It is where then we will get Painlevé. Yeah. Yes. But I would say that this is a way with this singular weights, and especially when I will, so my last topic would be to consider some sort of transition going. So I would take this weight, which we discussed now, and just make and just separate and just kind of make two branching from one inside, and another outside would be the good figure. And then I would just collapse them to one. And to describe this transition period, it is exactly as a local problem will appear Painlevé. This is a psi function for Painlevé equation. And so in this way, the Riemann-Hilbert approach in some sense more convenient than operator approach when you treat these singular situations. Because Painlevé functions should appear in an operator approach, it is not very easy to see them at once. Yes, I will definitely kind of say, yeah. Okay. I
don't know, maybe I missed some of technical things in the very end. So I had feeling that you don't worry about exponential terms in e power minus n, but here we see now O one over zeta, and zeta is proportional to n. Yeah, so it is now power of one over n.
Yes, so you mean, okay, let's go this. So this is this. So this is where I had z to the n everywhere. Yes, I have to z to the n.
Yes, so
you see, I move. So this comes from the very, very first problem for y. I had z to the n at infinity.
Yeah.
I did not like it. I just move it to the matrix, jump matrix. Mm-hmm. And this is a kind of the inheritance of this. So in the local problem, it is the same matrices. I just get rid of phi's. I have z to the n. But actually, that's it. So I cannot do anything with them now. I just then transform them to the exponentials.
Mm-hmm.
I just transform them. So again, in a sense, I get rid of n, just introducing them to the to the new variable.
Yeah, it's quite clear that there is interplay between n and small vicinity, size of vicinity.
Yeah, so u is fixed. So this radius is fixed. So it means that when I am on the boundary, this zeta is large. So it means that this neighborhood, when I go to zeta, becomes huge neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And in a sense, this means that, but I am kind of temporarily forget about it. I just want to solve this problem. And I have to see what is going on at infinity. And this is, I did not explain. So the things which I really did not explain, the thing which even if my presentation was perfect, and even if you followed perfectly up to the very end, there was still things which is not understandable from above. So even if I managed very well with this part, explanation of this is needed. It is not from above.
I see.
And in a sense, that would be my I kind of repeat the steps. But then the most important part would be to explain why I prescribed this behavior. I have to prescribe. So to set the problem, I have to say what is going on at infinity. And yes, and what is going on here too. But here it is easy. It is sort of inherited. But this one, I have to explain why I need this. But the point is, but again, the point is that now I have function, I have problems, there is no n. So again, this is going to be the things which would, of course, when I construct the parametrics, I would have to replace zeta again by n logarithm z, it would be, and we will show up. But it is just like, you know, when you solve something in terms of area function, you have area function with zeta, and then you go to the original variables, and you have n inside of the argument. So the same is going to be here.
Thank you, thanks.
But how to solve this problem? This is also has some kind of conceptual component. It is not, as I said, just to be clever and to just to there is a conceptual thing how you solve this type of problems.
You mentioned the Stokes phenomena here.
Yeah. This is exactly the part of this conceptual thing.
And there will be something kind of resurgence here.
No. I have not learned it yet. You see, we've been doing this. We've been, calculating Stokes matrices and constructed WKKB solutions. Well, 20 years before topological research appeared. So, and so we are. I want to learn it. I even kind of co-organizing a seminar, big seminar on next semester. Zoom, by the way, you might be, it is with Leonid Chekhov and Vladimir Rubtsov. And my goal is to learn it. But as I said, it should be, but it is more fundamental than topological research. It is just a very old 19th century again. Mathematics about the Stokes phenomena. And I will say a lot tomorrow about. So that is because this is how you solve this problem. Once again, not by, but it is exactly, this is why I introduced these letters S1, S2. So as I said, I will show, first of all, that the solution of this problem, if exists, satisfies linear system differential with rational coefficients. In sense, this system has Stokes phenomena. And this Riemann-Hilbert problem, it is just the manifestation of this Stokes phenomena. And this is the Stokes matrices. Without this exponent, this is the Stokes matrices. And the great thing about this particular Stokes phenomena is that it is special. We can solve it explicitly. We can describe it explicitly because we can solve this differential equation in terms of contour integrals. So there is, it is all conceptuals. So it is not, once again, it is not just, it is only because I was able, I can identify these matrices with the Stokes matrices for linear system, which this function satisfies. And this would give me the way to solve it. Yeah, no, that is important. But again, exactly because I have contour integrals, I don't need in solving, calculating this, don't need any resurgence also. I don't need any resurgence technique. I don't need any, you know, hyper exponential series. I don't need any of this fancy stuff. I just have old good contour integrals, yes. which the only way when you can to solve find explicitly Stokes phenomena. Mm-hmm.